Hi everyone, thanks so much for taking the time to come and listen to our stories. You know, Mpumi and I have been having this little debate of who has benefited the most. And that tug of war continues because I believe in my heart that I have. Coming from a background of educators and knowing very little about it because I've just entered into the realm of corporate life and work, I thought that I had it pretty together like Karen. Karen spoke about it. You know, we think we've got it all sorted until you put your foot out there and you realize that for the majority of South Africans, life is a challenge. And at the head of that challenge lies the leadership who steers the future of the country into the next realm. Because we are just here for today. And the future vests with our children. But nonetheless, I won't get derailed, I promise to you. So I got introduced to Mpumi on basically as his partner on 30 November. Tiens took me around to the school and I had on high heels the day. Lo and behold, Mpumi's school is on a slope and it's gravel. And so if you go with stilettos on a gravel slope, looking very fancy, you know, you're going to have to hold on to your learning process facilitator to make your way up. And so that was actually my exposure the first day. And we got to meet your deputy principal because you weren't there. So that is when we started. And then in December, Mpumi and I, I'm just taking you through a bit of a timeline. We had many coffees and during that time of December, January and February, Mpumi shared much about his school with me, such as the challenges being, as I listed there, the roles and responsibilities, trust issues emanating from, you know, from the staff, and where the roles and responsibilities are not clearly understood, one can somehow put it down to trust, but that comes from non-clarity. And so because there's non-clarity amongst people, they think that non-execution of tasks is because, you know, they're not trusted. And so we needed to just kind of unpack that and think it through. And he shared much with me, and it was a time just of listening to him, which was the pivotal challenge in my life. Because coming from that domain that Karen stressed is one of execution. You do. It's tick boxes. You've done X number of tasks this day, and that will determine your success. But in the life of a principal, of a leader of 1,000-plus souls, it's very different. And so you are dealing with people as opposed to tasks. And that's what I had to learn. And so come 4th of January, I don't know whether Mpumi still remembers this, we had coffee at Mug and Bean. And I listened to him again talk about the challenges of the school. And I don't think I shared this with you, Mpumi, but I thought, you know, I'd go back to corporate banking at the drop of a hat and do structured finance till it comes out by my ears anytime and to step into his role. And I listened to him and I remember telling him, Mpumi, I don't know what to tell you. All I can say is I'll pray for you. And I left. And I felt like such an absolute loser. Because, I mean, that is basically what you tell someone when you want to cop out. I'll pray for you, and then you, like, you know, just like kind of forget the problem. And I had turmoil in my tummy during January, and I thought, you know, that I'm supposed to be his business leader, notwithstanding that I'm also the person that recruits business leaders for Symphonia. And I don't have a solution in my mind for him. The first time in my life, I've never had a solution. And I felt like so defeated and absolutely marginalized. And then we met at Karen's offices at Steinhoff. Very fancy, everything is see-through, and there was no place to hide. And I thought that Mpumi was going to see, you know, and I couldn't even fidget under the table because the table was glass too. And then, and I thought that, wow, you know, Mpumi's not coming for the first half an hour, and I was so relieved. And I thought he wasn't going to come, and here he rocks up. And I felt completely exposed, and I thought everyone's going to see that I don't know how to fix this problem. For the first time since I've been working in Mpumi, I didn't know how to fix it. And I sat there and I was kind of, you know, off balance. And you came up to me and you put your arm around me and you says, yes, it's my leader, a business partner who means the world to me. And I could just die. Because before that, I wanted to leopard crawl out of the room in shame because I didn't have a solution to your crisis. And I felt so validated. Yes, it is him with a turban. And I felt so validated. And all I did was listen. I didn't do anything else. I didn't even have a solution in my mind. But yet you found it worthy that I was there for you and all I did was just hear. I didn't even reiterate or give you feedback in terms of what was happening. I remember asking you many questions with regard to all the acronyms educators use. Quintile, one, and IMG, and I don't know what still. I was trying to memorize these things, but without omega-3, it was a problem. But nonetheless, and so during that phase, it was, you know, just listening to what he said. Then came January, and I go and visit Mpumi at his school again. I'm better equipped this time, so I go with a pair of flat Crocs, and, you know, I'm sorted, and I go and visit him, ostensibly on the hottest day of Stellenbosch, 1 February. I go and visit him at the school. And incidentally on that day, my car's aircon packs up. And I get to the school and it's 12 o'clock. And Pumi lets the kids go home early because it was too hot. And so I think when it reaches like 40 degrees, you let the kids go home early. And I'm standing there in the staff room, which is all prefabs. And so it becomes like an absolute hot box. And I say, Pumi, I'm not feeling so good. And I'm hot. He says, yes, I can see you sweating. And at that point, my dress was stuck to my body like an old Elvis outfit. And I felt so exposed. And I thought, you know, I'm really undone here. Non-professional, standing here with my clothes stuck to my body because I'm sweating. And I said, we can't continue this meeting any longer. And I started developing a migraine. Must have been dehydration. And I go home. And I sit in my lounge. I've been moaning on my husband's head for a long time because we've got a completely open plan house. And I said, I can't work in this house. The children's on my case and Megan speaks more than me and I need a quiet place. And here I come home, Pumi, to a lounge with a ceiling in, with aircon, with ice water in my fridge. And I sit there and I can take my painkillers and it's quiet. And I can go and lay on my bed. And the house is not palatial. It's just a normal 3-bedroom house. But there's space. And you sent your kids home that day to go home to what? And I was ashamed of what I felt. Absolutely ashamed. And for the first time in my life ever, as a previously disadvantaged individual, I thought that I was in touch with the reality of the majority of South Africans, and I was not. I was so not. Because I didn't even have an iota of the challenges you face at the school and what your children go through. And so I sat there with gratitude in my heart and tears in my eyes and a huge migraine, but skrik van niks. And I managed to go and just lie down and I could recover. And you know, and then I reflected on these things. Then came that time of my learnings. And it was a time of reflection for me. It was a time as well where we went on community building together. It was in March, Mpumi. And where we were learning to take ownership of our destiny. Learning techniques and skills of how to powerfully interact and communicate. And you know, one always thinks powerfully interact and communicate is trying to coerce people or persuade them to see your point of view or buy your products or whatever. And that is actually the easy part. Trying to impact people who have nothing. Where, as Naomi would say, master facilitator that led us so well on 2 Saturdays ago, that unless the physiological needs are met in terms of Maslow's hierarchy, how can you even move on to the next? How can you even bother about purpose? If you don't even have food and water, if you don't have safety and security, if you don't have love and belonging, so where do you go to from here? What do you do? And this was a time of reflection and huge discomfort for me, Tians. I'm sure I shared it with you. I shared it with Gail and I shared it with so many. I had huge hydrochloric acid burn and stuff that I was thinking about that I never thought about before. All I worried about was that the plane was not on time and my presentations are not on par and, you know, running from one corporate meeting to the next door, just hit and run exercises. Now I was in a different domain. I was in the school of life. And I was learning. And you know, one person that added so aptly to my learning was a Partners for Possibility event held at Oude Molen. Brand Pretoria spoke. And I last interacted with Brand when I worked at West Bank. I worked at quite a few places, but West Bank was one of them. And he was then, I think, in charge of McCarthy's or CEO of Toyota, but nonetheless. So Brand was speaking now, and Brand was speaking on leadership. And I'll never forget what he said, because it resonated in my heart. It resonated to the very crux and core of Partners for Possibility. And that is that leadership is not, is an honor. Leadership is a responsibility. Leadership is not a right. Leadership is about the influence that you have must be earned. Where you have a high level of moral intelligence and emotional intelligence. You've got to have self-discipline. You must have a high commitment to truth and values. It is nothing in the face of that. And there's no substitute for the power of presence. The power of the principal. The power of being present in his school. And so you'll see it's so all intangible, but it's all about what we are. And that is when I was learning those things, through Mpumi, patience and respect, and I'll reflect more on that. But in terms of the change in me, that's where it was brought about. I was beginning to change from a human doing, an executor of tasks, which did it efficiently and diligently with an excess amount of verbal diarrhea, my family will tell you, and yes, I'm an English major, and so I can talk a lot and I can go on forever. And I love talking. However, that is not what it's about. It's about relationships. It's about how I lead teens. I'm not going to remember a word what you're going to say to me, teens, but the way you make me feel. And that's, at the end of the day, what matters. It's what I heard what Suzanne Ackerman said about 3-4 weeks ago when she spoke at a Ubuntu conference, and she says that she has learned three things. Nothing about the fancy stuff of living in France for 7 years and this, that, and the other, and whatever. She has learned to be more kinder. She has learned compassion, and she has learned to share. And so that's the whole concept of Partners for Possibility, and it just all resonates and comes back to me. Moving away from this aloneness of task to this task of, it takes a village to raise a child. It takes a street to be interested in what the child is doing, to be concerned about the child that is running around aimlessly at 8 in the evening, than to turn your back on that very experience. And so we are all responsible for our lost children, for our children going astray. We are all, it is all our responsibility, I have learned, to become active citizens, not in grandiose ways, in simplistic ways. Instead of being snide to the bergie or the homeless along the way, but to give him a word of encouragement. It takes nothing to be kind. And so I am on this journey of life, this journey of being more kind, this journey of compassion, and this journey of sharing. It also resonates with what Prof. Janssen said last year at the Cape Chamber when he spoke about education. And he says that even a thug can get a PhD, and we do know that. I mean, you've got such a lot of time in prison, you can do anything. But you will remain a thug. It's got to be coupled with values and morality in order to raise the standard in any society. Without it, you are just a thug with some brains who will then become probably a very clever thug, you know, and you come up with elaborate tasks. So Partners for Possibility to me, as I was reflecting and as I was changing and continued to change, is about servant leadership. It's about being a servant leadership at home, leader at home. And that is exactly what the principle is. It is about being a leader that shows, a leader that doesn't tell. And that is who Mpumi is. And I've learned through patience of listening to his story and listening to him share with me his huge role as a principal in a prefab area with so many kids. And so many kids look up to him because he could possibly then be the only dad that they have and the only role model as a dad. And he's got to keep it together for the sake of not one child or two children, but 1,000 kids. And also lead by example his teachers and his HODs. And so, I'll come to the Intians. And so my new perspective on SA has changed. And that was very important for me because I could easily fall into a diatribe of self-pity, into a feeling of lostness. And now you can't even escape out of South Africa because no one wants us. And, you know, and there's just crises everywhere. Where do you escape to anyway? And so the whole idea is, what do we do in a country where there are such huge challenges? We have to become engaged and active. We have to become interested in and involved. We have to do something. Otherwise, those very people that we're keeping out with our very high gates and our elaborate ADT systems and whatever, they're going to be on our doorstep anyway. And so what do we do to the child that doesn't have a father? A child that is the head of the home? We've got to reach out one way or another. And we don't have to do it in grandiose ways. We can do it in simple ways. We can do it starting with kindness and compassion without being judgmental, critical, or berating. And so it's changed my new perspective. Even in the light of the Rand-Dollar exchange and the whole crisis in what happened in December. And then I just became part of the furore and said that the leadership has gone to pot. And I was so angry. And we were still on a cruise, Louise, with friends. They're sitting here as well. And we were paying such a lot of money for Coke. I think it was 37 Rand a tin. It made me incensed. And when I reached the shores of South Africa and I saw our beautiful city and Table Mountain, I thought, I've got to change my attitude. I've got to shake this dust off my feet and be positive, not for me, but for my child sitting over there, Megan, if she's not asleep, and for my 19-year-old son, and for the rest. So my attitude changed. I then looked at Mpumi, and I saw a man that's energized, a man that's positive, a man that's the leader, not only of his school, but a community. And I developed hope. And I developed hope through you, Mpumi. Because you are really a positive person. I only have one regret of our partnership, and that is that you're not a female. Because, you know, sometimes I want to hang out with you all the time, and it's just so inappropriate. So, and so we just hang out, you know, during appropriate hours. And then there comes implementation. So Mpumi and I were talking, and he was sharing with me and sharing, and, you know, I'm his partner, and we're thinking about it. And at the end of the day, with all the stuff that he needs, you know, from heat and cold and just everything that he needs, I think of, in our circle, his school is probably the neediest in terms of what they need. He, with the heart of gold that he established that he needs to look after his educators. And that is where Naomi has come in, and we've then identified that in order to be a whole person, you need to have some introspection. You need to look inside and examine those little things that is not doing too well in our own life. And don't push it under the rug, because the rug's just going to get bigger and you're going to trip over it. Examine it. Look at it. Community building and flawless consulting brought it out. I remember sitting in flawless consulting with Louise, and I thought, you know, another cause that I'm going on, and, you know, I've been through so many causes, and, you know, if there's anyone that puts on so many causes, it's finance, because it's all about making money and margins. But flawless consulting is all about becoming the better you. Learning to be a better person, engaged person when you talk. A person that's interested in what you have to say, not just my story, not just your story, but our story. And how does it work together? And I'm a Christian, and then God's story. And how does it fit into my life? And to me, it has been thus far an amazing journey, Mpumi. A journey that does not end for me today, but is actually only the tilling soil of our friendship and our relationship and our partnership going forward. And what we and you have put in place and what you'd like to see through. And I want to thank you for this opportunity as your third time partner, third time lucky, of allowing me this time and allowing me the space in your life to partner with you. It's a privilege, it's humbling, it has changed me forever. Thank you.